Wow. There are hundreds of trophies in these cases. And behind each and every one of them, there is a story of loyalty and unselfishness and commitment and dedication. My name is Terry Sullivan, and this is The Inside Corner, a program whose mission it is to give information to both parents and players alike so that they might prioritize sports in their lives. Join us, won't you, as we discuss issues and topics both informative and provocative. Good evening. My name is Terry Sullivan, and this is The Inside Corner. Tonight's topic is fathers who have raised girl athletes. And believe me, it's an artful thing. It takes certain nuances and sensitivities, special attentions. I'm surrounded tonight by four accomplished dads who need some credit. the much maligned father of the girl athlete. Four of them are present with us tonight. First of all, Bob Clark, who is the father of six daughters, all of whom were college athletes. And Marty, of course, who played at Duke University, those of us who have seen him on television. But there were Margaret and Sharon, who played at Pepperdine University, scholarship basketball players, Katie at University of Illinois Chicago, Annie at DePaul University, and Allison at St. Benedict's College in Minneapolis, Minnesota. And next to him is Al Heydorn. Al is here for special reasons, to kind of temper out the group. Al is the daughter of a freshman in high school at Lyons Township High School, a freshman, Mallory, who is presently a regular on the varsity basketball team at LT. Next to Al is Bill McManaman, whose daughters Kara and Maureen matriculated at St. Ignatius High School. Kara, a volleyball scholarship player at Northwestern University, and Maureen, scholarship basketball at DePaul. And over here to my left, from Oak Park River Forest High School, Mr. Tom Dunne, whose daughters Liz and Kate and Meg have all played soccer and, believe it or not, rather obscure endeavor, field hockey. And it is both Kate and Meg who are college athletes in field hockey, Kate at the College of Worcester and Meg playing field hockey at Indiana University. So I think we're covered. We've got it covered. We have four experienced dads, one who is in the midst of it right now. So let's get it going. Let's get it going. Let's find out. Let's find out if there is a stereotypical father of a girl athlete. I don't think so. My research shows that we have some very unique treatments. Treatments that work. Treatments of daughters. All right. Did all you guys coach your girls?
I coached.
You coached? Did you coach Bill?
Yes, I coached both.
Yes. Al, you coached your daughter?
Yes.
Bob?
All of them.
All of them coached my daughter. And is it in this coaching, is this coaching, that is it that which provided your fondest memory?
There have been a lot of good memories from that. Several state tournament championships with the oldest daughters, state tournament going to with Katie and Annie and Allison. It's been very pleasurable, but I think there's also a lot of other things that stick in my mind, as the first prom, the first date, the first recital.
See, this is what we want to hear. We want to hear about real priorities. Good. So it wasn't all about jockism.
No.
There are some of these affective things. The prom was a highlight, no doubt about it. When she walked down those stairs in that beautiful dress and that boy waiting for her, all six of them, oh my God. Six times through prom. Oh my God.
From there they went from a jock to a beautiful woman.
Yeah, right.
And it was quite, and I know that most of the other fathers here would probably share this with me too. Sometimes you got to blink your eyes a few times just to make sure you're looking at the same girl that wears shorts and goes out and shoots baskets or plays volleyball or plays soccer.
Excellent. What an indelible memory that must be. That's great. That's great. Now, Bill, is your fondest memory of your daughters, is it wrapped up in some athletic setting or is it outside of that?
Well, it depends upon which daughter. With Kara, who's the oldest and 32 and has just moved back into the neighborhood and just had her first baby, it was when she was a baby, actually playing in a mud puddle. dipping her blonde hair into solid mud and then watching it drip down her face.
Yeah. I have an image much like that of my own daughter.
Now with Maureen, it was different. It was probably, she was in first grade, and my two nephews, Brian and Kevin, who played for you here at LT, we were up watching a soccer game in Western Springs, and she was in a co-ed soccer league, and in the first period, against boys, she scored three goals, and we all looked at each other, and we thought,
this
kid's a little different
than
some other kids.
So
that was my fondest memory of Maureen, and it was in first grade.
Yeah, isn't it remarkable that you have that? What about you, Tom?
Well, I think that when I think about my most fond moment was when my daughters were playing. They were probably in seventh or eighth grade in a, on a traveling soccer team. And I went to the game, and it was rainy, snowy, ice cold, a lot of mud, and both teams, they were on the ground all the time, slipping, sliding, mud. And I mean, they were drenched from head to toe, and they were laughing. And they kept laughing throughout the game.
The joy of it all.
The fans were laughing, the parents were laughing, the kids were laughing, both sides. I mean, they really had a good time. And then we all took pictures afterwards of how muddy they were, and they just loved being in the mud and participating. And it didn't matter who won or lost that day. It was just great being there and with what they did, and they enjoyed it. And luckily, it continued that way too.
It has continued. Have they recaptured that kind of joy?
It was,
play?
Even now, when I've gone to several games, and I put a lot of time on the road this year with both of them being in different schools, and even with the rain, the heat, I mean, it just, they love the game, field hockey, and they just go for it.
Most of us wouldn't understand field hockey. I've watched it at the high school level. LT has boys involvement, but I've been out and around, and I've seen Nutrier play and whatnot. This is a physical sport.
It's very physical, and you have to be in such great shape, and it's a game that you have to watch for a number of years before you get used to the whistles and the penalties. And it's a very protective game by the referees because there's really, other than shin guards and with the sticks and the ball is, you get hit with a ball, and my daughter has plenty of stitches in the in her head and from the ball and from the stick. It's a real tough game, and but very, very physical.
Hockey's in the terminology. It's got to be rough and tumble. Yeah. Okay, Al, your daughter is the youngest. Now, is she only 14 or 15? Which is it?
She's 15.
She's 15.
Right.
So you don't have your recall is a lot more fresh than the other guy.
Yeah, I'm still in the middle of all this.
Yeah, right.
I'm still in the middle of all
That's
this.
Why I'm glad you're here. What's your fondest childhood memory?
I'd have to say she's always been an emotional player, and she plays really hard and enjoys the game. Mm-hmm. When she was in seventh grade, they won the seventh grade championship, and she was named MVP. And when that all happened, she just was, I've never seen her that excited. Mm-hmm. They talked to her, interviewed her, and the whole thing, and she was just extremely excited about that.
This is basically the same thing Tom is saying. He's talking about elation in play, even though the play you described wasn't competitive play, I don't think, was it? And Bill, for that matter, the joy of her tumbling in the puddle is an elation that you hope they have in sports, right? That they experience that again. Mm-hmm. So, for you, that's been doing it.
That's the whole purpose. We got both her and my son involved in sports is to get the enjoyment out of it and have a good time and learn how to compete. And when you see that much enjoyment out of it, obviously something clicked and went right, and that's a good thing.
Okay, I'm gonna stick you now. I'm gonna ask you, what's her most feminine quality?
Her most feminine quality. Mm-hmm. That's tough. I don't know exactly what you mean by feminine quality, but she's a typical girl. Mm-hmm. I mean, she likes to wear nice clothes and go shopping, and she's a striking girl, and
so she's fashion conscious.
Very fashion conscious, yeah. Especially when it comes to shoes.
Mm-hmm. Shoes, yeah. This is a womanly guile. I mean, the guile of fashion. So she's very. This is a very effeminate girl, even at 15. I mean, she's
unquestionably. I mean, she's a girl.
Regard, yeah.
I mean, she's a girl who happens to play sports and play them hard, but she's a girl.
And Bob is describing a prom experience in which he saw this beauty coming down the stairs. So they've evidently, we have at least two daughters in the group here, and we'll get to you guys, but we have two daughters who have preserved their femininity. Very much so, correct? What's your daughter's most feminine quality, your daughter's?
Kara's is, I think she was born to be a mother. She's been maternalistic, I think, since she was in grade school. And now she's been blessed with a son, and she's actually pregnant again. So we got another one on the way, which I'm enjoying the heck out of. Maureen is very different, and always has been. She's the caboose of the family. You know, she's 8 years younger than Kara, so there's just a big difference. She's 6 foot two, and she loves to wear 3-inch heels and be 6 foot five.
Which
sort of intimidates me.
Yeah, but look at the self-confidence in her.
Yes, and she loves it.
Yeah.
And, you know, and then she'll go with all the fingernails and, you know, and smell great and look wonderful, and she's 6 foot five.
But the picture of femininity and motherhood, both, I mean, mother.
Very different.
See, this is the reason we bring this up. The reason I'm asking this question is because I'm trying to show dads at home, and moms in particular, who are afraid that there'll be some femininity loss if girls participate in athletics. Why should there be? Why should there be?
Well, I don't think there is. When I think about our kids and the way it started out, you know, my wife Lynn and I, we just, with the sports, we just knew that we wanted them to be in at least one sport, to learn group activity, interaction, be part of a team. So I think we started out in about second or third grade in one of the park district type things. And then it just grew, and we always just said, you know, we want you to be in one sport. Mm-hmm. Then they chose to be in two and three and four as time moved along without us pushing it. I mean, it was because that's what a lot of kids did, both park district and traveling teams.
You didn't push them.
No, not really.
Did anyone else push them?
No, we really didn't. It just, just a little osmosis, I must say. Mm-hmm.
Peer group type thing?
A lot of the kids were in the sports who lived around us and actually have gone on to college and played sports too. But it wasn't parents pushing. It certainly wasn't the coaches pushing. It was, if you got time for sports, you got time for studies, you got time for church, you got time.
Yeah, yeah.
But then just by themselves, they just decided at certain periods of time that I want to play another sport. That's fine, as long as it works in with everything else.
They conferred with you before they pursued.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And when you had these private talks about athletics, where and at what age did those take place? Where did they take place, first of all? I'm interested.
At
home?
At home, usually. We had we made it a point to always eat dinner together.
Okay.
No matter what. You know, 5 o'clock, 5:30, or when sports are, we're going to eat together. Mm-hmm. That's something we always did.
Even their sports?
You know, 7:30, 8, 9 o'clock. Yeah. That's when we ate.
Very difficult.
So the five of
us. Burdensome on moms.
Well, the five of us would be together, and it was the only time because we, you know, we'd have a, I don't know how much to get into this, but we, on a refrigerator, we always, you know, have the map of the week with everybody's responsibility. And that was the only way that you could keep track of everybody with the sports and the church activities and other activities. So we always made sure that we met every night for dinner and had house meetings, 6 o'clock every Sunday night to set the stage for the week.
Man.
Because it was
an organized.
Well,
he's very organized.
I mean, it just everybody
it
needed to know
it's
their
very
job.
Healthy. Don't
and,
get me wrong.
And Lynn and I always made it a point to try to be at every activity.
Yeah.
So we had to divide it up who was going to be where and when. And
so if they were to ask for advice or the teachable moment came along, you were you were readily available.
I was
because you had a schedule.
I had a schedule.
Okay.
And Linda.
And therefore access.
Yes.
Yeah.
Linda just sort of, she paid the fees, let's just say. Yeah. Might be in tape here.
Yeah.
Linda paid the fees, all the activities and the workshops and things, and I did a lot more of the nitty-gritty work with the kids.
Yeah, we've had moms on. We did a show a while back, Moms and the Sacrifices They Make for Their Athletes, and the moms confessed that they often felt as though much of the practicalities, the practical responsibilities about the sports involvement of their children fell upon them, and the actual contest became the domain of the father.
The males, yeah.
Okay, Bob, with six daughters, can you recall a crucial point in time with any of them wherein you had to counsel them about their sports involvements? And what I want to know now is at what age did you have this private or crucial conversation about whether or not what one of the six of your daughters should go on?
Well, I don't think I ever had that kind of a conversation mm-hmm. with any of my kids, except when it got down to selection time to schools at a later date. Yeah. Athletics was always a means to fund for the kids. It was never forced upon them. We always had our NBA game of the Sunday out in the driveway mm-hmm. and where mom participated and all the kids. We had a group, obviously, after a while. We had a lot of kids. We played soccer, we played basketball, we played baseball, we played everything. But there wasn't a time I was pretty much involved with their athletics, making sure if they wanted to learn, I taught them. If they weren't interested, I didn't, because I was always out in the driveway myself getting some exercise, trying to stay in shape a little bit. But I don't think I ever had to sit down and talk to them, except for maybe Marty one time and say, look, you know, you really got to, he was playing everything like the typical young male. Mm-hmm. And I said, you know, you really should try to pick a couple things that don't conflict with one another and try to focus on those things. But, you know, I would say around the sixth or seventh grade.
Do you think your advice improved by the time you got to the last daughter?
Oh, yes.
Or your interventional methods?
I don't think I intervened in any of their decision making, because it had to be up to them what they wanted to do. Mm-hmm. You know, one of my daughters who didn't play in high school, and that was 6'1", but she had some coordination problems, but she played in grade school, and she enjoyed that. But she didn't. She wanted to get into the arts, and I thought that it wasn't forced on her. But it, you know, she enjoyed. Great. She did other things. She went to the games. Yeah. She kept stats. She did things that she enjoyed.
Let me intervene here for a second, because we have to break right now for a public service announcement. Please stay with us. We'll be right back.
That was 15 minutes.
When property is at risk and lives are at stake, we get moving. We're the Air Force Reserve. Our mission? An aerial assault on Mother Nature's most daunting adversary. We're there working to save our forests, to save our communities, and to save lives. Air Force Reserve aerial firefighting may be a part-time job, but it's a full-time experience, and just one of many exciting careers in the Air Force Reserve. Call 800-257-1212. Air Force Reserve, above and beyond.
When you head back to the U.S. from a trip abroad, it's nice to bring back something special for friends and family. But if you bring back something that's prohibited, like a bird or animal product, you risk exposing the country to harmful microscopic organisms, like the virus that causes foot and mouth disease in livestock. So please, make sure you leave prohibited agricultural products behind and choose a gift that will never become a pest. For more information, call 1-866-SAFEGUARD.
We're back. Thanks for joining us again. The topic tonight is fathers who have raised girl athletes. Now, it's a rhetorical, you know, we know mothers have raised girl athletes too, and we've done that show, so please, a little deference to the dads who are much maligned. I'm trying to break the stereotype of the father who's the aggressive, assertive, pushing the girl ahead. It's not always the case. I think we have four reasonable dads right here who are recounting their experiences. Al. Did Mallory ever want to quit?
No.
No.
She's never wanted to quit. We've had to step in a couple times and steer her when she's had opportunities to play on.
Okay, describe that. Steering. Tell me about the steering.
Well, she had an opportunity. She played on a traveling soccer team that's mm-hmm. disbanded and then kind of reformed, but it was farther away and required more time commitment than we previously been involved with. And we just looked at that and said, you know, there are trade-offs here. And the trade-off is you spend less time with your friends, you have less time for schoolwork, you have less time for school and social activities. Mm-hmm. She was in eighth grade at the time. She also had some opportunities, I think, to play on traveling basketball teams, and we did the same kind of things. We just said that we didn't see the trade-off as being worth it to her. But other than that, there's never been an instance where she didn't want to play or we had to talk her into, or we never would talk
her into. Are you anticipating that perhaps happening? I mean, she's only 15 now. She has a long way to go.
I don't see it, no. Yeah. She's going to be on an AAU team in the spring and summer.
And summer.
Mm-hmm.
She'll also be on the high school team in the summer,
right.
Plus the AAU team in the summer.
Right. So she's really committed and thoroughly enjoys it. And
this becomes
I don't see
a religion rather than a sport.
Yeah, it does. But no, I don't see any any change in that at all. She is young, though.
Yeah.
Bill,
yeah.
Did you ever have that crucial teachable moment discussion, that private discussion with one of your girls about persisting or balancing things out? I'd like to know at what age, too, was that? Can you
remember? Well, actually, I had it with both daughters, mm-hmm. and at various times. The difficulty today, and Bob mentioned it earlier, is you got to make some choices. Mm-hmm. A lot of these girls like to play multiple sports, and both Kara and Maureen played both volleyball and basketball. And they began playing, both of them, in grammar school. It got much more difficult when we got to high school playing two sports, because both of them played varsity basketball and mm-hmm. varsity mm-hmm. volleyball, as well as playing club for both.
Wow.
And you play the opposite. When basketball school is in, volleyball club is in, and vice versa. And the schedule, and you're expected to make practices. So you'll have...
So they're going 7 days a week.
You're going 7 days a week, and frequently you'll have multiple practices in a day. And trying to balance this for the kids is really tough. And it really gets to be a hassle. And you're trying to advise them on, couldn't you just mm-hmm. choose one of these? But both kids love both sports.
Okay, so it was they were high school age when this crunch came where something
yes.
had to be.
Right. Now, Kara played 3 years of basketball and 4 years of volleyball. Maureen played 4 years of both. And, since she played only on the varsity team, it really made it tough, because she would not be hanging around with her friends while she was doing this. She would be playing with kids much older than her, much like Mallory. So it was tough, and it was very difficult to offer advice.
Yes,
it was really yeah. back to Tom's point. You had to really be organized.
Yeah,
and poor old mom was typically the driver that took the kid from. The school practice to the club practice, or vice versa, and it was a logistics issue.
Plus, the danger of it. I see it for dads. Is they don't want it. They want the girls to sense the ownership of what they're doing, and when they see the girls floundering, or son or daughter floundering,
right. They
don't know if they should intervene as the and offer advice, and will that be perceived as advice or directive by son or daughter? And once the advice is given, do the kids go on to take ownership, or are they following what you want them to
right.
do? Very difficult, artful thing to manage.
Right. And you don't want them to burn out. Sometimes when you know that they're going to be playing a sport 12 months a year, and you recognize they're a high school student, you wonder, what's enough?
Did they talk about quitting?
Oh, yeah.
They did.
At various stages.
Yeah.
Kara, I remember at the end of her sophomore year at Northwestern, she was not exactly happy with the playing time she got the first couple mm-hmm. years, and she was pretty dejected and really thought that she wanted to quit. And I remember a lunch that she and I had up in Evanston one day. It was just her and I, and we threw the issues on the table, and we had a sobby
yeah.
lunch. She decided to stick it out. She became the captain of the team, and she loved the last 2 years.
This is exactly the moment I'm trying to get to. This was the moment.
And it was a very tough discussion. Because
a tearful discussion over the table at lunch.
Oh, it was a crying, it was a crying lunch.
But it worked out. She becomes captain.
Right.
And subsequent to that.
Yeah, and I think she enjoyed her last 2 years. I think she, getting back to how she is as a mom,
mm-hmm.
Her mentorism came into being, and she mentored the young players and played very well the last 2 years. So it was a lot of fun for her, I think.
She's going to make a great mother, I can tell.
Yeah,
she is. I can just tell by your description and her involvements, I can envision this and see her being a wonderful mother. Did she have any non-athletic interests that were put by the wayside, or maybe they were maintained? Did she have any non-athletic interests?
To be quite frank with you, neither kid had time.
They didn't have the time.
I mean, other than academics, which Kara was an academic All Big Ten for all 4 years.
Wow!
And Maureen,
remarkable.
And Maureen was an all-academic player at DePaul. It was amazing with the amount of time that, that these sports took, that they were so well focused and did so well. But, you know, other than sports,
I think research shows, at least in high school, that athletes get higher grades than non-athletes. There's an organizational confinement there that causes them to do somewhat better.
I believe it.
15-year-old Mallory, does she have a non-athletic interest now that she's fostering?
I'd have to say no. Early in the year, she was involved with the art club, but obviously once basketball season started, that had to go by the wayside. She does enjoy ceramics and those kind of things, and hopefully she'll maintain that. But again, it's a time issue. Time is a big factor.
Now, Bob, this is a good question for you, because you said you have six daughters, five of whom were steadfast athletes. And then it's the sixth daughter who has the cultural interest.
Well, it's actually five. Allison's the baby.
Okay.
And so it was Kristen that was more into the arts.
Okay.
But I think all of my kids shared interest in other things, particularly in the music area. Mm-hmm. I mean, some of them played instruments, piano, the violin. Marty played a guitar. And I think that was an escape for them, really, away from the athleticism, because it became, you know, very important.
A healthy contrast.
Yeah,
right.
And I think that
tension
was good,
because
you would always find them at the piano, you would always find them playing in the room, you know, listening to music and things like that, and then they were into the arts, you know, as far as, like he mentioned, ceramics, and some of the girls really enjoyed art. I know Allison did a lot of, and Kristen did a lot of artwork and a lot of ceramics in school when they were at LT. Now, some of that goes by the wayside on the next level. And getting back to what Bill said, you know, most of my discussions with kids about my children, anyway, about quitting, and that all occurred in college when they got discouraged about coaching situations, time being played. All of those things became a big factor later on, not so much when they're in their younger years, because they just did everything with such amount of energy and they loved doing everything. So, but later on, then you have to make some decisions. You know, you get an injury, you have a coach that doesn't quite respond to you the way you think he should or she should. So
I would hope any athlete, boy or girl, would have some sort of balance, some outside interest to balance out, if only for the sake of tension release. I think this is what Phil Jackson was trying to do with the Bulls. He'd hand them books, you know.
The Zen master.
He would hand them books, whether or not they read them. No one knows. But he would hand them books to develop more than an outside interest. It was an attempt to engender in them some affective interest that would allow them to see another dimension of the game or another dimension of life, and therefore put the game in perspective. I would hope every athlete would have, would go on to persist with non-athletic interests. Now, all you guys coached your kids, your daughters. How did you separate coach from dad? How did you do it?
Well, when I coached soccer and softball in 7th and 8th grade.
Did you ever bench your daughter?
No, didn't have to. But luckily, you know, we always had two or three coaches. Mm-hmm. And they also had kids on their team. So it was real easy to say, hey, would you mind?
Yeah.
You know, I mean, so it's a balance, you know, because you're trying to, you know, not have your nose into your kid too much.
That's
but at the same time, you'd like to coach her just the same as you would anybody else's child. So it's a delicate balance, and I mean, yes, I'd find myself yelling at them, you know, as I would somebody else.
But did it carry over to the dinner table?
Not really, because I think what helped me later in talking to my daughters at various times, they'd say, okay, how'd I do? And I'd say, do you want an honest evaluation, or do you want me to blow smoke your way? You know, says, no, I want to know. I said, well, you know, you need to do a little of this, you need to do a little of that, but overall, you know, looking good.
Yeah.
But, you know, I think you could...
Dangerous.
You know, well,
very dangerous.
You have to temper it.
Because when you begin to confuse the approval of, and love, when the child begins to confuse approval based on sports with real love and approval from father, oh man, this is a mess.
Well, you know, I think I've used that term delicate balance three times the last 2 minutes, and that's what it is.
Okay, and this is exactly why you're here, Tom. It's why all you dads are here.
You can't get in front of them and
That's right. That's what this show is about. This show is attempting to explain for a viewing audience what this delicate balance is in the management of girl athletes, and boys for that matter. This is pretty universal.
Yes.
But it's that delicate balance.
Well, they always, everyone tries to say, well, boys are different than girls. Duh. I think we have that.
That's why they're from Venus.
But it's... Well, we guys from Mars have to watch it, you know. But it's really, it's just, you know, I think a lot of it is just at a feeling level. And if I had sons, I think it would be the same thing. Yeah. It's just, it's being generous in approval. Yet at the same time, just say, you know, well, would you like some, you know, and they say, well, yeah, you know, and you just, you have to temper it. You have to temper things.
I think one thing that's real important when you're dealing, if you're involved in coaching with your kids, is making sure that the kids understand you treat everybody the same once you hit the floor. And if they see that, they have a lot more respect. Mm-hmm. Yeah. You show any sign of favoritism towards somebody, and you lose kids mentally. Yeah. And I think that probably one of the, if you talk to any of my daughters, they would tell you that they got treated just like your daughter would get treated, or your
which
daughter.
Which made the whole scene much more understandable
right.
for them.
I demanded perfection from everybody. I demanded that everybody do the drills. Mm-hmm. I demanded everything. Mm-hmm. You know, you have to be that way, and when someone does something very well, you compliment them, whether it's your daughter or your daughter. Mm-hmm. It didn't matter, but they expected that. I think as a coach, you have to do that, and if you don't do that, then you're going to have chaos, and you won't have a group of kids to coach. You know, you don't belong in a
very practice. Artful, very artful. Have you had any troubles being dad and coach?
No, I really haven't.
Separating
the
roles
seems to be a line that just kind of created itself out there. You know, a lot of instruction on the court and on the field.
Are you still coaching her?
No.
In the summer or anything?
No. No.
No way are you involved in
it? I'll assist, but I mean, I just fill out books and whatever, but nothing else. Mm-hmm. But one of the things I would do with her is, and my son as well, whenever anything had to take place, for example, the first sub in a basketball game, she was always the first one out. And to this day, she doesn't like the fact that she was always the first one out. But it was just a statement of we're all equal here, and you know, oftentimes.
Bill?
I use the same technique that Tom did. You know, I coached the St. Francis Grammar School for 17 years, and. In Kara's case, I was lucky enough to have John O'Halloran be my mentor, and he used to be in charge of Kara. And in Maureen's case, I had Sam Cibula, whose daughters played here at LT, and Sam took care of Maureen, which was terrific.
Okay.
And so that worked out well.
Took a lot of pressure off.
It did. Yeah. It did. But it is, you know, it's always tough coaching your own kid. I like to say that. Even when you try to be even-handed, if you really have that interest, you're probably just a little bit tougher on your daughter than you are on the rest of the
definitely.
Kids.
Yes, very definitely. There's the tendency.
You know, I would pull my daughters out first out of any game that we were either winning or losing by a lot, and then they'd be asking me on the way home.
You regret having done that? Do you regret that you might have been a little bit more harsh on them?
I don't regret it at all.
Why were you? Because your expectations were higher for them?
No, my expectations weren't higher. I just thought that they ought to know that that the other kids obviously deserve a chance to play. And, you know, and obviously, both cases, they were both excellent players.
I think this is something they don't really come to appreciate until they're adults and they have perspective and they look back at what your treatment was. I'm not so sure they understand right then and there, unless they're extremely mature kids.
Yeah, I think that both, well, first of all, I think girls mature a lot earlier than boys do, as we all know. And pretty much by eighth grade, they know what's going on. So
I had great difficulty with my sons.
What?
Yeah, if I may recount this, this is not a daughter story, but my sons, I had both my sons who came through the varsity baseball program. I suspended both of them a total of 3 times. I know now it's much harder on them than it was on some of the others. I always kind of acquiesced and appeased the others for the sake of their psychology and sociology, but my own guys, I hacked them 3 times.
Yeah, but it's
and I kind of regret that now because they weren't treated fairly in that regard. I had higher expectations, and I should have been more mature about that and handled it. They've forgotten it, thank God. Of course, they still bring their laundry over, so I guess I'm okay. Now, in terms of emotional readiness, this is the controversial point. Emotional readiness. When, how and when did you know your daughters were emotionally ready, or as they call, might call it too, mentally tough enough? And of course, the accusation on girls is that they're not emotionally ready and they fall apart under duress. Have you identified it in your daughter? Daughters?
I never, when I thought about that, my girls, they always seem tough. I mean, they just always seem tough.
They're all park kids. Yeah,
and part of that, I think, is just, as I mentioned, they start about second or third grade with the, the playground soccer, which is really, as we all, pretty loosey-goosey. Yeah. You're like, oh my,
like
how long is this going to go on?
Yeah.
I think it builds up. I think, especially when, at least in our case, we never forced another sport on them. Yeah. They took it on themselves. They wanted to do
it. So they were they brought readiness to it.
Their levels just kept rising without us really getting in their face saying, you need to do more.
Tom, let me postpone this question because there's readiness here for another public service announcement. We'll be right back. Please stay with us, okay?
Breast cancer doesn't just affect women.
If I saw you in heaven.
This year, over 40,000 women will die. The Breast Cancer Research Foundation has given over $20 million in research grants. Please, help us make a difference. Call now, 1-866-FIND-A-CURE.
This is the story about a group of kids who volunteered.
Doing something nice for someone.
We fixed stuff.
Did some art projects with the kids.
We fixed up his house.
We worked in the woods.
Cleaned up the park.
Did something for the planet.
We just did it.
No other reason.
And you know what? It was great.
At first, they didn't know each other.
Well, that didn't last long.
This guy is really funny.
Me? Ace are my new friends.
Are you into it?
Call 4-H or check out our website at areyouintoit.com.
Thanks for coming back. And tonight's topic, fathers who have raised girl athletes, continues. I want to know about their stamina, their physical and emotional strength, and when you identified that, their readiness for that. Because I'm afraid in the stereotypical image of the girl athlete is that they don't have that endurance in the spiritual, emotional, or physical category. And I want to debunk that. I want to hear father's observations about that. Now, you were describing your two daughters in field hockey, certainly physically, and you need durability in that sport. But what about the rest of the stamina?
Well, I think that, and I think their stamina somewhat imparted from, grade school days and moving on up. But as I recall, they might be at soccer practice at 5:30 in the morning just working out, and then would go through four or five advanced placement courses during the day.
That's brutal.
Then would have another practice in the evening.
Yeah.
Would come home, and then they were churchgoers and would go to church once a week.
Disciplined kids.
And they'd be up till 12.
If they can handle that's what I would consider emotional readiness, as far as I'm concerned. Now, all your daughters, Bob, all of them, there had to be variations in that readiness point, that emotional, mental toughness, readiness. Describe some of that transition to that point and the differences between them. They're not all clones of each other. We know that.
No, they're all very different.
Yeah.
And the older ones, who were in the 6'5", 6'4", were around basketball a lot when I was still playing and coaching both high school men and college men. And they saw a lot of things that became second nature to them. And when they hit the 7th and 8th grade, they were 6'1", and they were quite a handful at that time because they had a lot of knowledge that I didn't give them. They listened and came to my practices and knew a lot of things, and that made them mentally tough, I think.
Mm-hmm.
And then they were so physically big that they were ready at an early age to play against greater competition. Now let's go, if I could go to Marty for a second. Marty was an eighth grader and was 5'7" and 110 pounds. Now what happened to him? I mean, he grew a lot later, and he was mentally tough, But he wasn't physically tough as a,
By the way, were the girls bigger than your son?
Oh, yes. Oh, yes. They were. The girls were 6'1", 6'2", in the eighth grade. Marty was 5'7". Katie, Annie, Allison, every one of the girls were...
Marty looked up at his sisters.
Marty was picked on by the two older sisters and by Katie and Annie. I mean, he was...
And therefore, his mental toughness
came from a different source.
Yeah.
So, but I think the girls were ready, and what we talked about off screen was that I think they're ready earlier, mine were anyway, to participate, and there wasn't anything special they did, and they just did all of those things to be, you know, to really get involved. They enjoyed it. Yeah. They enjoyed the extra mile they had to walk to be an athlete. Mm-hmm.
Well, and that's the same way it was with our kids, especially the girls, because we had the boys at the top of the family who were older and were playing already, and Brian and Kevin and Marty were always challenging Kara and Maureen. Actually, they were for a long time they were teaching Maureen, but once she got to be accomplished, they would challenge her as well. So the girls got a lot of physical toughness from the boys, and they got a lot of mental toughness too, because they would challenge them and say that they weren't as tough as they were, and obviously that point was up for discussion, especially once the ball was out on the court. So it was interesting to watch them grow up that way.
You think Mallory is tough right now?
Yeah, I think she's always been a mentally tough kid. What I was going to say is that I think that the mental toughness escalates, and sometimes we've tried to help her along there a little bit. I think that she, not just her, but kids get to a point where they need someone to point out to them that, you know, you have the skills, and maybe this game you didn't produce the way you normally would produce, or the way you would like to produce. And generally, we've done this a couple times with her, and she has basically signaled to us that she's not happy with her game for whatever.
Does she cope with that?
She copes with it pretty well. I mean, she gets annoyed, but then
she shows resilience in that regard?
Yeah.
When things aren't going right, when they're not going in the basket, she's coping with it.
Yeah, she does a pretty good job of it. I mean, she understands, especially at this point, that games are like that, and you have to figure out a way around whatever that is and how to contribute in another way. One of the most effective things that we did at one point was she had gone through a stretch, and I think this was in soccer, where she just had a couple games that were okay, but probably not up to her capability, and she probably wasn't that happy with them. And then she had a really good game. And so both my wife and I said, you know, the game that you just had that you're real happy about, that's the level you should be shooting for every time you step on the field. And if you can shoot for that level, you know, you might not get there all the time, but if you shoot for that level, those other games aren't going to happen very often. And that's something that's, since then, I don't think she's had a real bad game either at least effort-wise, in basketball or in soccer. And I think that's something, you know, 3-4 years ago, we couldn't have told her that. Yeah. Mm-hmm. And even if we had, it wouldn't have made any difference. But we do try. She's a tough kid. And she
Well, she must be, because she's playing at a sophisticated level for a 15-year-old. I mean, she's playing in the West Suburban Basketball Conference. It's a tough conference. She's on the varsity as a freshman. She must have some resiliency. She must have some positive imagery going for herself. It's probably a natural process for her, and anyone's taught her that. But
yeah, I think
she's got to have it.
Part of this is innate. I mean, she came to the sport in this world with some of these qualities.
And you see, that doesn't make her any less feminine. That's another point. Because she's mentally tough doesn't mean she's any less feminine.
No.
I don't know what we're looking for, the dumb blonde or what we're looking for. They, you know...
Doesn't
an athlete can be intellectual and sensitive. Right.
I remember my daughter was, one of my daughters, Liz, when she was at Oak Park, and she was a goalie. So we finished the game at 12, and they have the homecoming court for homecoming game. We walk over, and I'm staying around. She says, "You want to walk out with me?" And I said, "Where's your date?" "He's not here." I says, "What are we doing?" She says, "Well, we're walking out there, picking the homecoming queen." I said, "Yeah." So you walk out there, and here I'm, you know, 50-year-old guy walking out with my daughter, and she gets named the homecoming queen.
Wow.
And I'm thinking, it doesn't get any better.
That's right.
You're an athlete. Yeah. You're a homecoming queen.
I mean, what do you do now?
It gets back to femininity and all the rest of it, and how kids are looked at by their peers. I mean, you can be an athlete. You can be a homecoming queen. You can be anything.
Just said they have more opportunities today.
Yeah, definitely. Which is really tragic too that generations past.
I mean, your wives, right?
None of our wives had that opportunity.
The GAA, right? Wasn't that it?
Yes, right. The Girls Athletic Association was about the weakest club enterprise. They tried to make it substantial, but there wasn't a competitive aspect, interscholastic competitive aspect that kept the thing viable. Yeah. All right, now I'm going to ask the nasty questions. It's time for that now. You guys have been off the hook. I want to know, why the heck didn't they go in ballet? Why didn't you let them do ballet?
My girls started in Irish dancing. It goes back to first grade when both of them started in Irish dancing, and they took it all the way through eighth. I wasn't that interested in it, but I obviously got pulled to the south side frequently, and it was one way I think that not only did they learn significant coordination and balance and rhythm. Mm-hmm. But I also think that it really improved their self-esteem.
How old were they?
Like I said, they started first grade.
First grade, you said.
Now, I don't think they actually danced competitively in front of a large group until third or fourth grade. But then they would dance in front of a large group all by themselves. I mean, and that took a lot of...
Let me tell you, again, this is another irony. When we would have, when parents would come to me and say, what other sports should my child play other than your baseball? What can he do to be a better baseball player? And I'd give the same answer as somebody said, what can my kid do to be a better basketball player? It wouldn't matter what sport. I would say they should go into drama. And they'd look at me like I was nuts. And I'd say, no, because what is more self-reliant than being up on a stage or in front of a group and public speaking, so to speak? What takes more self-reliance than that? I mean, I couldn't think of anything more risky and jeopardy-filled than standing up in front of a group and laying your expressiveness on the line. Mm-hmm. It, for me, it was akin to being in the batter's box. It was no difference for me. So the Irish dancing in front of the... heated Irish audiences at a Gaelic park made them better basketball players. I'm sure of it. No one would be able to measure that, but I bet you it did.
I agree. Yeah, I bet you. I agree wholeheartedly. Yeah.
Why wasn't Mallory? Why wasn't she in? Was she ever in Girl Scouts?
Nope. But I think we have to take the rap
why
for
not?
Some of that because we didn't put her in it. We, my wife and I, just you know, I enjoyed sports and I thought it was a lot of fun, and mm-hmm. I wanted my kids to do it, and so we put them in there. And, you know, if they would have expressed, I mean, they both played piano for a while. They both were in the band for a little while. They never took to that stuff other than, you know, do it and be exposed to it and then see if you want to go on. But, you know, we put them in sports and they just, you know, really enjoyed it. And they wanted to do other sports. I mean, they didn't ever ask us if they could be in, you know, ballet or anything else like that.
And you feel confident that you made the right choice?
Oh, yeah. I mean, we never denied. I mean, they could, a lot of their friends are doing those kind of things. And if they wanted to go do it, they could do it.
And you're confident that she's doing it for her own sake?
Yes. Yeah.
She's expressing this now at 15 on the girls' varsity basketball.
Yeah, she just says she loves it.
Of course. She's in the light.
Well, she loved it before this. I mean, she loved it in sixth grade and fifth grade. And I mean, that's
she
why
would
she's
predict
still
to be the best player. Would she not? At 15 and she's on the varsity already, why wouldn't she be the best player eventually? With all that experience she'll accumulate by the time she's a senior.
She'd love to be the best player. I mean, that's, you know, she works hard and loves doing it.
So, of course, now she's in the limelight and she's thinking, well, I made the right decision. Lo and behold, some prima donna comes in and takes the limelight away. I wonder if you'll have the same answers for her.
I would say yes. She just likes to play.
Yeah, I've watched
I don't think that it's you know, the fact that she's the best person or close to the best person. As long as she can play.
One of the first questions my scouting bosses ask me when I scout baseball, does this kid like to play? And you have to be able to read that body language. I've watched your daughter play. She likes to play. She's not doing this under duress.
No.
She likes to play.
No.
That means so much. And I saw your guys play. I haven't seen yours, Tom. I've seen the Clarks play. They like to play. Mm-hmm. There's no doubt about it.
Yeah.
All right. What was it then for you guys who are past tense dads and for you, Al, who are present time dad? Well, Tom, so are you. What is it in the end of all of this that you want for your daughters? What is it? What's the ultimate result? What really is it? Now, Bill's guys are moms. One is a mom.
One's a mom.
So I don't think he could ask any more than that. If you're asking more than that, you got a problem.
I'm right? pretty happy okay. with the way she's
What are you What are you asking of this situation? When they finish their field hockey at Worcester and at Indiana, what are you expecting?
Well, you know, I think when we were speaking earlier about this, what the kids do other than the sport, and I got to go back just a little bit to my kids every summer would go to the Appalachia Service Project, kind of like Habitat for Humanity. Mm-hmm. And they'd go down for 10 days, 2 weeks, sleep on the floors, go out and help build houses and repair roofs and rip out bathrooms. They loved it. It was like, you know, they were pigs in the goop. They just loved it. Yeah. And they kept doing that and doing it and doing that to where now they're graduating, and the twins, what they plan to do is go to work for Habitat for Humanity, the Peace Corps, or Teach for America, or something where, okay. even with their degrees.
I get your point. Your point is, you know, athletics did not erase their idealisms.
No.
It didn't.
Good.
And yeah, evidently it didn't erase your daughter's idealisms, because she's a mom and sacrificing for a child. What about the idealisms amongst your daughters?
Well, I have two grandchildren, one on the way. I have a CPA. I have two teachers. I have a couple of management people. And they're all pretty intimidating sometimes. So it's pretty enjoyable. And not only do they do their own work, they work long hours because young people have to work long hours to get ahead. They spend a lot of time giving back to, I'm sure, Maureen, I know your daughter. Mm-hmm. I've seen your daughter play. And the kids, they like the sport, and they give back to.
And don't let anyone dare argue that athletics doesn't teach unselfishness.
Oh,
it does. Absolutely.
And time management. Yeah. It's all of those things that we so-called talk about. Right. These, I think it's more. I think the female athlete is better organized. It's easier to teach, and shows more improvement than males. Any day, and I know I'll get slapped a few times.
Well, no, you know, our last show, one of our last shows, we had three lady coaches on and a girl, a prestigious girl athlete, and the girls' coaches, one of whom coaches both boys and girls, she is admitting that the girls are more teachable, more flexible, and I think that by and large, there's some worthiness to this stereotype that girls are more accepting readily at the outset. They're not as suspicious to make changes. Now, Al, got a long way to go yet. What are you going to expect of her at the end of it all? How do you see her? What's her fruition as an individual, finally?
Well, that's a good question. I mean, she's 15 years old. I mean, when we got her involved in sports, just like we got my son involved, it was with no goal other than to get them involved in sports. And basically, it was no goal other than for them to have a good time and get some exercise. Mm-hmm. Whatever has come from it is what it is right now, and I don't know where that's going to go. But basically, you know, if we could end up where any of you guys are with family and children and all those kind of things, that's a great thing.
Yeah.
It's the best.
From what you've heard here, would you care to have some of these choices that these other girls have made? Do you think they've made good choices?
Oh, I think that sounds outstanding to me. Like I learned a lot here.
You'd like to cherry pick some of the choices for your own daughter.
Yep. Well, I think the girls know so much about themselves. They know so much about other kids and their teammates. You know, my girls went down to the inner city. I think that was a good experience for them. You know, Kara, who is pregnant and has one, coached this year. She coached seventh grade volleyball girls. Maureen helped me coach fifth and sixth grade boys. You know, as Bob says, they're giving back to the sport, but, you know, it's just all about life. It's just the way it grows.
There are connections to real life. And I'm glad you had you on, because your testimony is that this can be done, and it can be done in a reasonable way, and that there are fathers who don't mold kids in their own image and likeness, that there are kids like yours and yours and yours and yours who have their own image and likeness and have shaped their own futures, and they're doing so well, and sports definitely played a role in that. I'd like to recommend now at this point in time some reading for our viewers, particularly these two books, Parenting Your Superstar by Robert Rotella and Linda Buckner. I found it particularly interesting as I researched for tonight's program. And this one especially by Mariah Burton Nelson, second book of hers I've recommended on the show, Are We Winning Yet? How Women Are Changing Sports and Sports Are Changing Women. And so there you have it. Fathers who have raised girl athletes, moms too, of course. I want to thank Bob Foskett, our supervisor. On camera, we have Mike Kevorkian and Lee Novak. and Mike DeJacques on sound, Candy Fay, my director, my main man, my boss, Mr. Mike May. Thank you, Mike. Thank you, Bob. Thanks so much. Al,
thanks, Terry.
Good luck, Mallory, if you're listening. Bill, Tom, it's been my pleasure, so very interesting. Stay tuned next week. Please, won't you come back and join us as we discuss how to choose a coach for your child. This is Terry Sullivan. This has been the Inside Corner. Good night.